I'm dealing with this topic for over 10 years, and what always seemed to bother me is that women did so much in the 20th century. They challenged practically all of the stereotypes that there were. We got more educated in almost 100 countries in the world. Women are now already more educated than our male partners or friends, and still we are being less paid and also denied that position. And it's a question whether and how we can go beyond that.
There is usually a question of why. Why is it like that? And why should we actually worry about it? The world still turns around even if women are not in top positions. But actually, it was calculated by various institutes and United Nations and so, that actually, if we would achieve a gender parity, we would increase by $28 trillion our global GDP, because women are actually a resource, a human resource that is not being used as it could be. And since it's not used that much, it also doesn't bring the same value as it could. And then again, if we say, okay, there is a financial reason that women should be better included in economy, in different work aspects. So if that makes sense, why are still so many women lacking or being left out from the market? Well, the first goes to, at least for me, when I break down these questions of why, it goes first to the assumptions about women. And those assumptions are that not that much is actually expected from women. And if there is a boy and a girl, of course, as a parent, we want them both to be successful. But even within the family and from the society, the pressure on boys to be successful is higher than on girls. And girls grow up with that it's not that much pressure on them to be successful. And if there's not that much pressure, there's also not that much nourishment. And anything that would help you in realizing your self-esteem. And so the expectations of the society are lower for girls than they are for boys. And so with that, also there are lower expectations from us as the individuals. In average, we have lower expectations of us than probably boys have of them. And with that, we have these two trends that go hand in hand. Since not that much is expected from women or from a certain woman or a girl, it has a direct impact on our self-esteem, which is lower. And on the other side, we really tend to be very self-criticize much more than men do. And these are actually two of the same things. Low self-esteem and high self-criticism, they really don't boost your confidence. They don't and they don't work as motivators. They work as obstacles in seeing yourself what you could be. And how does that apply or turn out? In two ways. First is that even with today, when women are highly educated, they hold careers that are time consuming, still in every country, women work more, they have more unpaid work. So that means that they work at home, take care of the household, take care of the children more than men do. These percentages are changing. Men are stepping up. They, especially younger generations, they don't want to be father figures. They want to be part of the family. But still, women on average, in Slovenia, for instance, they work 2 hours more than their male counterparts. So that makes them, in a way, like a household heroes, and that makes again a feeling that women are predisposed to be housewives. But cooking or cleaning, it has nothing to do with how you were born. My husband or my my son can vacuum just as well as I do or as my daughter does. And when we come to cooking, my husband is much better than I am, for instance. And then the thing that I stress usually the most is the issue of double standards. All of those assumptions and low expectations actually turn in that even when we have the same level of achievement, we will not see women's achievements as high as men. Let me elaborate on that. In one of the really nice studies that was made in US is on symphony orchestras. In 50s, last century 50s, the symphony orchestras usually had out of 100 members, musician members, they had only two women. And usually one was a harpist because it was really, really difficult to get a male harpist. And when music directors and conductors were challenged, why don't have more women? Because women were studying and they were musicians. The answer was that women tend to play differently, that their tone is not as such as they would like to have in their orchestra. And then in 1956, Boston Philharmonics were the first to challenge that. And they had the first blind audition, which meant that they had their candidates, they put them behind a curtain so that they could not see them, whether there was a man or a woman. And they conducted their audition. And it turned out actually that they still chose more men than women. So you could say, okay, they proved that the gender has nothing to do with whether you're the gender has something to do if you're a good or not such a good musician. But then they said, okay, maybe we made a little mistake. Let's next time when we have an audition, let us use the curtain but also a rug. So let's have people walk on that rug or take their shoes off so that we cannot know whether it's a woman in high heels or it's a man walking up. And guess what? When they did this really blind audition, the chances that a woman would be chosen were a little bit over 50%. So with that, it proved that if you don't see or hear until they play that women have the same possibilities, but only when the people who choose don't know there is a woman behind the curtain. This was proved many times later on in science, in architecture. And one of the examples that I like also a lot is the one that's been conducted at the Faculty of Social Sciences in Ljubljana. Dr. Aleksandra Kanjua-Mrčela, who is a professor at that faculty, makes an experiment that is in a little bit different way than in the US otherwise. But it goes like that. She has a paper, a seminar paper, and she gives this paper to be graded to her students. And she has male and female students. And the only difference that the students don't know is that half of them got a paper that was supposed to be written by Marco, a boy, or Moitza, a girl. And when she gets that paper back, it turns out that Marco would pass the exam with grade 8 and Moita would barely make it with grade 6. And that story teaches us that the discrimination that goes towards women is done by men and women. It says also that it doesn't have much to do with the generations, that it's the young generations that discriminate against women just as well as the older ones. So it's something in the way we are raised, in the way we breathe or drink water or something that makes it so difficult for women to be taken as equal, that their work would be appreciated on the same level as when done by men. So double standards are something that I think is the most difficult to change. And I will finish with saying, okay, what I think can be done with that? What is the call for action? Sure, the governments can do a lot. Slovenia is a great example of that. We are on number 7 on the World Economic Forum's ranking list. Our social infrastructure is such that makes it possible for women and men to have careers. And yet, it is not enough. Even in Slovenia, we have the same percentage of women on top positions as anywhere else, which means really, really low. Not enough as it would be. It would be okay. So it's not only the society and the government that have to do something. In fact, it has to do everything with us. And when I talk about that, I usually get a feedback, yes, Sonia, but you have to talk about that with men. It's men who have to understand that. Sure, I agree. But first, it's women. Nobody will fight for women's rights as much as women can, because we feel it. Men cannot see the difference because they never were in our shoes and they never saw that there is a difference. Many men are sure that they don't discriminate, that they're objective. And yet, it's also women that discriminate are not objective, and we think that we are. So what we have to do first is to start to think about these things and don't wait for the others, but try to challenge yourself and see, when did you discriminate against another woman? When did you discriminate against you? When did you not cherish or not appreciate something that a woman did? And go back. Think about that and change your attitude. Think whether you, when you name your top movie actors, how many of them are women? When you go to see a film or so, do you choose them also if there's a woman? Do you give her a chance to make it, to prove it to you that she's actually really, really good? So, try to start with you. We can be the change, because women are worth it. And you, if you're a woman, are worth it, because you will change the world. Thank you.